And welcome back on this beautiful Monday to the next chapter in the daily read. Now, Romans 9 is deeply, deeply deep. This doesn't even make sense. It is. If Romans 9 were a food, it would be baklava, right? Have you ever had baklava? It's I'm gonna butcher this. Google check me. I'm pretty sure it's like an Eastern European dish. My friend Tim Porter made it for me, or made it for my family one time, and it is a labor of love. It is just layers upon layers upon layers of very thinly, it's like dough and good. It's like if you were to bite into what joy tasted like. That's what baklava is. It's just really dense, but it's a labor of love to do, and it's a lot of just stuff. That being said, Romans 9 is baklava. And when we start thinking about what it means to look through the layers of what's going on here, I think it's easy. Have you heard the phrase before of sometimes it's easy to miss the forest for the trees, right? So like there is a time where especially in the text where we have to go deep. We have to not only go up to a set of trees, but we have to go up to an individual tree. And then we have to look at like different pieces of bark on that tree because it's helpful and because there's so much just kind of packed in there. I think part of the difficulty with that is, though, when we begin to look at individual barks on the trees, we can become so overwhelmed and kind of burdened with the different pieces of bark and how do they relate to one another that we forget that it's a tree that we're looking at and that tree belongs in a forest. That being said, part of Romans 9 that I think is helpful at kind of shoving us back out to look at the entire big picture is down towards the bottom of the chapter. And so I know that you're a grown person and you're figuring out Romans 9. There's all kinds of resources online that you can look at. The gift of Google in this time is wonderful. But here's verse 25, and I think it's just really helpful because it kind of encapsulates the entire point. Quoting from the Old Testament, "Those who were not my people, I will call my people. And her who was not beloved, I will call beloved. And in the very place where it was said to them, 'You are not my people,' there they will be called the sons of the living God." What's interesting about this is Paul is using this to talk about the relationship. Again, and you might be tired of hearing about this at this point, but Paul is just continually talking about, in the entire book of Romans, the relationship between the Jews and the Gentiles. And there's such a deep divide there. He is threading this needle through of helping them to understand in Rome what exactly is God doing here. And I love what he points out in Romans 9, that the reality is that the Jewish people at this point had continued to reject God again and again and again, so much to put his son on the cross. Now, granted, Jesus rose from the dead, as it would have it, but like they put him on the cross, they crucified him. And so, in fact, just a few verses later, Paul talks about how Jesus was the stumbling block, but all in the entire sovereign plan of God that those who weren't a part of the Jews could come into faith. Now, here's why that's good news. Here's the takeaway that you can begin chewing on in the baklava of this passage. When you think about being able to believe in Jesus, I think that should just be a huge source of gratitude. Because the reality is we often ask ourselves the question of, why would God do this? Why would he do that? And I think a lot of it is just the wrong questions, right? And instead, I think perhaps a helpful perspective to consider would be, why have I been even allowed to taste grace? Because you see, that gets back to the heart. Like, so mercy is not getting what you deserve. Not getting what you deserve. So if you deserve punishment, mercy would be not getting that punishment. But grace is actually getting what you do not deserve. So it goes beyond just not being punished. It's actually receiving a gift when you should be punished. You see how that works? And so the reality is Romans 9 is saying, listen, the Jews and the Gentiles both should receive punishment. But not only have they not received punishment, but they've been both now given the gift of believing in Jesus. And so when we begin to think about that context at large, it really makes me think as a non-Jew, I'm just really grateful because the reality is that not only did God not have to, or not only has God not punished me, but he's giving me the gift of believing in his son and entering into a loving relationship. And so while Romans 9 can be wildly layered and really deep and kind of sticky, it's also beautiful in the sense of when we zoom out and look at the forest for the trees, man, like the reality is that as people who are not Jews, we have been also now given the invitation to become sons of God. And I think that's a beautiful thing. So let your Monday start with that. Let that be your encouragement in the start of however your week is going to turn out, that God is for you and has invited you into his family. Love you guys, and we'll see you tomorrow and on Tuesday with Romans chapter 10.